Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 5, Natural Language Processing, Part 4. This is the last section of language models and engrams. So what did we do so far? We tried to define a statistical language model, which means we want to compute the probability of a sequence of words. With the help of the Bayes theorem and the chain theory or chain rule, we are able to determine the probability of a sequence of words based on the occurrence of each single word dependent on the history of the preceding words. So this was the Bayes theorem and the chain rule. We also saw that we do not necessarily need the complete history, which means the complete sentence. So with the help of the Markov assumption, we only look at a few preceding words, which then leads us to the engram model. Now we only had to solve the question, how do we now really compute the probability of the occurrence of these words, which means we need to have some empirical evidence for that. And this could be done based on the maximum likelihood estimation method applied to huge text corpora of natural language texts. By that, we could simply reduce the original problem of determining the probability of the occurrence of words and sequences of words to counting the occurrence of single words, of bigrams, of trigrams, and so on and so on, and simply then look at the normalized n-gram frequencies for the probabilities. In this section of the lecture now, we want to apply that on an example. So we have an example corpus. Of course, this is a toy corpus. It's only small. We have there three sentences. I saw the boy, the man is working, and I walked in the street. And you see here, we have two symbols to denote the start and the end of a sentence. The vocabulary then is the number of all of the different words we are using. So you see here, V, the vocabulary with I saw the man, I saw the boy, man is working, walked in street. So these are our words in the vocabulary. Okay, now let's estimating n-gram models. So the first thing, we already did that. Each sentence is bracketed by a special start and end symbol, as you see here. Now we count the frequency of each n-gram. So we start of the sentence, so start symbol plus 2, which is the first word in our sentence. Then the next would be to be, and so on and so on. And for all of these n-grams, then we are counting simply the frequency. And in the end, we are normalizing the frequency. And then we have the relative frequency estimate, which comes close to a probability. This is what we are actually here doing. So, first of all, let's have a look again at our corpus. I saw the boy, the man is working, I walked in the street. If I now simply denote all the unigram counts, you see here this little table is created. Also denote that for S and slash S, which is the beginning and the end of the sentence, of course, we have counts here. And then we simply updated this kind of table and complemented it with the bigram counts. So here you read simply now in the row, you start by boy. Boy is then combined, for example, with the end of the sentence. This is the very end of the first row that you see here. So once boy and end of the sentence occurs. So you read this table in that way. So in red here is marked only the occurrences. How often is the beginning or the end of the sentence occurring here? Okay, so these are our base tables with the frequency counts. How often do now bigrams and unigrams occur? And what we want to do here is we want to make the estimation of the maximum likelihood estimation for a new sentence, which is not in our corpus. So for example, what's the likelihood then that a sentence like I saw the man would occur based on the 2-gram model, which means we have the probability of the sequence, which then should start, of course, with I followed by the start symbol, which means I should be the beginning of the sentence. Then you want to have the probability of the word saw, second word, based on the assumption that I was already said. Then the probability of the word the, based on the assumption that the word saw already occurred, and so on. So this is then the estimation of the probability of exactly the occurrence of this new sentence, I saw the man, based on the counts in our corpus. And we simply then try to do these relative frequency counts, which means we normalize them. So we have the bigram counts here in on top, and then below we have the unigram counts, and then I set in simply the numbers, which means the bigram SI occurs twice. However, we have three sentences that start, we have to divide it by three. So it starts with 2/3 times. Then I saw occurs once, I occurs twice is 1/2, and so on. And then you multiply all of these probabilities and you come up that the likelihood estimation, so the probability of the occurrence of the sequence I saw the man, comes up to 1/9. If you want to do this example, then, you know, in real, in a Python notebook, we have prepared for you a collaborative notebook with exactly this example. So simply follow this link or follow the course of this lecture, because this notebook then will be also part here of the lecture. So far, so good. One thing we still have to address is, what if some words or bigrams are missing? So what are we doing with so-called unknown words? What if a word occurs that is not part of our vocabulary? For example, what's the likelihood that there is now the sentence, I saw the girl? You distinguish between two different kind of worlds. You have the close vocabulary assumption, which means your test set is only allowed to contain words that occur really also in our vocabulary. However, we are living in an open world, which means more often the open vocabulary assumption holds, which means the test set that you're going to test here can contain unknown words, which are also referred to as out of vocabulary words that are not part of our vocabulary. So what are we going to do in an open vocabulary world? So in an open vocabulary system, unknown words are simply modeled by adding a pseudo word, unknown here. So this is a pseudo word, which means I start with choosing a fixed vocabulary. Now I have a training set, and every word that is in my training set that does not occur in the fixed vocabulary, I mark as out of vocabulary, as unknown word. And I do exactly the same then in the test set. And what I do then is I estimate the probabilities for the unknown words, simply like for any regular word. I could do it that way. However, yeah, since all of the unknown words, and if they occur frequently, they might then get a rather high probability in the end. So this doesn't help us any further. At least it only helps us a bit further, and is of course not a correct, or let's say totally correct solution. However, so what else can we do? Sometimes we are not only considering unknown words. The problem is that in our corpus, many times specific n-grams will not occur, but I need a probability for them. Look at the following example. This is again our three sentence corpus, and we have a new test set. I saw the man in the street. Okay. Problem with that is then the following, that if I now continue in the way I did this before, so first of all, I take according to the base rule, the conditional probabilities in my 2-gram model, and then I use the relative frequency counts from my corpus. The problem is that man in is a bigram that never occurs in my corpus. So therefore, if I try to estimate then the relative frequencies, and then I do the multiplication of all of the single probabilities, the conditional probabilities I use here, the result will be zero, simply because, yep, if this sequence, if this bigram doesn't occur, this affects the complete rest. And then I have the problem, yeah, I can't say anything, then the language model doesn't work anymore. So how do I deal with that? Look at the Shakespeare corpus. We already know that the Shakespeare corpus contains of more than 800,000 different word tokens and has a vocabulary of roughly 30,000 word types. So only 30,000 word types occur of possible set of course, 475,000 words that are referenced in the Webster's International Dictionary. And of course, there are words then not in the training data if I consider the Shakespeare corpus. The probability of every unknown word now is zero. Another thing is that even then, if I look at the bigrams, and we have already seen that, only 300,000 bigrams are really used by Shakespeare in the Shakespeare corpus, which means these are 0.04% of all potentially possible bigrams. So the probability of 99.96% of all possible bigrams would be zero. This is, of course, rather low. So what to do then with a test set that contains sequences which are not in our test corpus? And of course, the larger my N is, the larger my sequences are, the more serious will exactly this kind of situation become. So what can we do about that? We have to use some tricks. And one of the tricks is simply robbing the rich for the poor. And this technique is called or referred to as smoothing. So what we do for smoothing, the very simplest version of that is the so-called Laplace smoothing. The name comes from famous French mathematician and astronomer Pierre-Simon de Laplace. And he came up with this kind of smoothing technique when he tried to estimate the chance that the sun will rise tomorrow. So that's the so-called sunrise problem. So his rationale was that even given a large sample of days with a rising sun, he still cannot be completely sure that the sun will still rise tomorrow. So this is the sunrise problem. And there he came up exactly with that kind of little helper. So what we are going to do here now is we assign a small probability to all unknown n-grams that do not occur in my test corpus. So for example, I simply add once, so that let's say a previously unknown word occurs once in my test corpus. And I handle it exactly that way, which means I simply add one to all of my numbers I have here in my bigram table. So I simply increase the frequency of all words, including of all bigrams, including all bigrams that do not occur, by one. What happens then is the following. So if I now want simply to find out about, you know, what now here exactly is the probability of an unknown or also a known bigram sequence, of course, then the number of bigram counts that I'm looking for is increased by one, which means then if I take the normalized version of that, I have to take it in relation to every potential, you know, combination of the first word in my bigram and any other word, which means this again is increased by one, which means in the denominator we have to increase the value by the size of the vocabulary. So this is then the new probability that you can use. And therefore, for all of the non-occurring bigrams, previously they were zero and now they are one, which means they have now also a small probability. And with that, of course, you can then make your estimations as we did them before. Of course, this is a rather simple trick, and of course, it's also anything else but abstract. So it's not optimal. It's okay for domains where there are not so many zeros, so where this doesn't occur rather frequently, or if you only do text classification, then you don't really care for how many or how oftentimes this bigram occurs or not. Most commonly used for smoothing are more advanced methods. One of them is called Nisanay smoothing. And this is quite interesting. So what you do there, so you try to calculate the probability distribution of n-grams in a document based on their history. So you interpolate probability of an n-gram considering probabilities of the preceding n minus one grams. And the point is, if you don't have, let's say, now an n-gram, you look, is there an n minus one gram with that word? Is there an n minus two gram with that word? Does it occur more frequently compared to combinations with other words and the rest of these grams? And by that, of course, you come up with a formula how you could interpolate in the end then exactly a value for the occurrence of these so-called unknown words. So the probability then is simply interpolated from what already exists there. What you do then for rather large corpora where, you know, you simply would have to make too many calculations or too many probabilities for an n-gram model, there is a stupid back-off method, which means, okay, we filter out, of course, lots of stuff that had to be computed. And one of the possibilities you can do there is, for example, you store only n-grams with a count that is larger than a given threshold, or you use entropy to prune less important n-grams, so you make the size of the n-grams you are using here smaller. Okay, but we won't go deeper into that in this lecture. If you are interested in, simply look into the references, then you can go much deeper into this advanced language modeling. And of course, what you can do next is you can see our n-gram language model notebook, and you can either do the walkthrough together with me, or you do it all on your own and you simply play around with it. So enjoy and have fun.